All right, the number of participants seem to be stabilizing. So welcome to today's webinar with the topic from strategy to daily tasks and how to make OKRs relevant in your everyday work. To start things off, I'd like to give a short intro of the company WorkPath and obviously of me as your host today, starting with WorkPath as a company. We are a platform company, a software company, whose value proposition is to get faster from strategic goal to business results. So we, in general, are at the core a software enabling big corporations to connect the strategy to the operative work. At the bottom, you see a couple of examples of companies we are currently working with. And as I said, at the core, we are a software company. So our platform tries to enable strategy execution leveraging the OKR framework. Meaning that, as I said, at the core lies the software platform itself, and we offer an end-to-end approach working with partners, but doing enablement ourselves as well, and facilitating one ecosystem and community in order to get together OKR practitioners around the world in different corporations in different roles. That said, maybe one or two sentences to me as your host today. My name is Philip. I'm responsible for everything around training and enablement here at WorkPath. And before WorkPath, I was with a big corporation responsible for the overall agile transformation. And before that, I was a consultant slash agile coach, as I'm assuming a lot of you today's participants are as well. That said, already enough of a short intro. Let's dive into the webinar itself. But before we get to the content itself, I'd like to ask you a couple of questions up front. It will be three questions, and I'd like to ask you to actually type in your answer in the chat. Question one would be, from which location are you currently joining this webinar? To make the first step, we are sitting in Munich. That's our headquarter, but we got employees in Spain and Berlin currently as well, where we are planning to open up our next locations as well. Please give us a hint where you are joining from. So we got Munich as well. We got international colleagues from Prague, Warsaw, Stockholm, Stuttgart, Berlin, Zurich, all right, Mumbai, India, a couple of other German cities, the Czech Republic. Okay, great. So pretty international. Great to have you in the webinar, which brings me to the second question. Do you or does your company already work with OKRs? And three options, a simple yes, a simple no, or a kind of, if you feel like you started but didn't get the hang of it yet. Every day, kind of. Okay, seems to be like a 50-50. Nobody's not working with OKR, which is obviously not surprising since you joined a webinar talking about OKRs. But a couple of you, 50% more or less said kind of. Seems to be with a lot of corporations. It's a big topic right now. It's not a new topic, but it's a topic which gains speed kind of in the last couple of years. So kind of is what we often find with our customers as well. And last but not least, one more question. How would you rate your own OKR knowledge from 1 to 10, and 10 being, I feel like invented OKR. So 10 is the best, 1 is the lowest. There are no wrong answers, but maybe give us an indication who we are dealing with. Okay, we got like 3 to 8 with most of you kind of in the middle. Okay, no surprise there either, but still thanks for bearing with me for the three opening questions. That said, let's dive into what we are wanting, what we are discussing today. We brought with us, for once, an overview of measures to ensure the relevance of OKRs in your daily working life. Then after this overview, we'll deep dive. We will pick one of those topics and deep dive into the topic initiatives, so the operative work, the connection between strategy and operative work. So first off, we'll try to understand the difference between OKRs and initiatives. Then we'll try to learn a little bit about the way to derive initiatives from your OKRs. Next, we'll try to learn how to leverage initiatives then to reach your OKRs, and trying to get some answers and questions on how to better reach your OKRs in your organization. So what we'll try to do, my part, my input will be a little bit more than half of the session, 30 to 40 minutes. Then we'll have about 20 minutes left at the end for some questions. And I'd like to ask you to use the the Q&A function of this Zoom meeting to ask your questions regarding the content. So we'll be able to actually see them in one list afterwards. So please don't use the chat for content related questions. If you got anything else to share, use the chat, but questions please in the Q&A function. Okay, that said, let's dive into the overview of potential measures to ensure the relevance of OKRs in your everyday work. So we collected a couple of potential measures without the goal to have every potential measure obviously here on the slide, but to give you an overview. You could say that one overall topic obviously to ensure relevance is change management. So every company, and we try to focus on that at the beginning when working with all of our customers, is to understand that strategy execution leveraging OKRs is a transformation and a change project. So you should understand it as a change project like it is. And as in every change project, one goal is communicate. On the other hand, it's one pitfall a lot of companies jump into to introduce OKRs and thinking it's just another tool which won't change that much, which it actually isn't. I believe most of you will know that since most of you are already working with OKRs, or at least kind of working with OKRs, it's a big change. And as a big change, you need to communicate a lot and do proper change management. So in order to ensure the relevance of OKRs in everyday work, one of the potential measures is actually change management and evolve a complete communication package around the introduction of OKRs. Next one is, we call it adjacent processes. So OKRs or the OKR framework and the strategy execution leveraging the OKR framework is no standalone process. It's something which you need to understand in the context of all processes connected to strategy company in strategy execution in your company. So what you need to do is take a look at how does strategy execution currently work or should work, and what kind of processes are connected to the strategy execution and by that the OKR framework itself, and then adapt the OKR framework accordingly and integrate it in the adjacent processes. At the very least, you need to make sure, as part of the change management, again, you need to make sure that everybody involved understands how OKRs and strategy execution leveraging OKRs are connected, for example, to performance management, to onboarding, to employee development, to controlling, budgeting, portfolio management. There are numerous adjacent processes which need to be linked, or at the very least, at least made transparent how they are connected. Next one we see a lot with our customers is the OKR input. So in the planning phase of our OKR cycle, one of the potential measures to make sure that the OKRs are more relevant in your everyday work is to actually make sure that all relevant input sources are considered when you are drafting. Otherwise, there's the risk of a competition between different input sources. And input sources could be pre-existing commitments, personal goals, top-down, bottom-up input, and much more. So what you need to make sure is that when drafting OKRs, you don't just take, for example, an overall strategy and break it up and put it in OKRs, but you consider personal goals, you consider performance management topics, you consider predefined already commitments, for example, of big programs running in your company where employees in your area need to participate in or deliver something. And all of this and much more needs to be considered when drafting. So the drafting itself as a phase or as a meeting needs very good preparation. And by preparing the OKR input accordingly, you can make sure that the OKRs which come out of the drafting afterwards are more relevant in everyday work, because the teams won't have to choose between, am I working on this OKR or am I working on my personal goal, for example. Next one is, again, still in the planning phase, capacity planning. So our tip always is, in order to make sure that OKRs are actually considered in everyday work over the next cycle, is to do a proper capacity planning when planning your OKR cycle. So you need, for example, to decide upfront how much capacity can or should be spent on the OKR-related work, and how much capacity, for example, is reduced or saved for operative day-to-day work, which isn't really strategic. Because most companies decide on just putting the strategic work in OKRs, meaning it's only one part of my capacity in the next cycle I will spend on actually working on OKR-related work. And next one is the one topic we will do a deep dive later on. It's we call it initiatives. And what we mean by that is, still in the planning phase, that companies should ensure the linkage of the strategic OKRs and the operative task to make the OKRs reality. So what we usually, or more often than not, hear from team members is that the OKR don't actually have any connection to what they work on daily, with a huge number, which a huge percentage of their capacity over the next cycle. And by linking the operative level to the strategic level, you can make sure that the OKRs itself are more relevant in everyday work. What that actually means, we will dive into in more detail in 1 minute. But to finish this slide up, we got a couple of more potential measures. One is moving from the planning phase to the alignment phase in our OKR cycle. It's under the topic contributions. So by reducing the risk of surprising contribution requests, which every team, I believe, in a big corporation know about, you can make more sure that the OKRs stay relevant over the whole cycle. So you should do a proper alignment phase or alignment workshop or alignment meetings before actually kicking off the next cycle. So after drafting or initially drafting your OKRs, you should align them with adjacent teams or neighboring teams or interfaces out of your next to your area, and make sure that you know about everything which is already foreseeable in the next cycle and might come back to your team as a contribution request. By knowing those contribution requests up front, you can make sure that you prioritize right and don't have to reprioritize and reprioritize over the cycle, and thus making more sure that the OKRs stay relevant over the whole cycle. Two more. Moving from the alignment phase, then after the kickoff, into the execution phase, so starting the cycle and actually working on the OKRs, you should try to derive different action items in order to make sure that the focus on OKRs stays prominent in everyday work. You can ensure the focus on OKR-related work, for example, by regularly communicating, having them in different meetings, which you anyhow are doing, talking about OKRs there, by doing short and appealing check-in meetings over the execution phase, and including, for example, check-in elements in other meetings of your daily work. For example, if you're working in a project and you got a key result which is related to something you do in this project, you should talk about the key result itself as often as possible and the results following the key results. And last but not least, after the execution phase, there's the adaption phase. Like in every good iterational process, we are trying to continuously improve the process of working on OKRs and executing strategy itself. So by keeping the process alive, by making continuous learning a habit, for example, with a retrospective, and prioritizing then the implementation of at least one improvement item per cycle, You make sure that the OKR-related work and the process around OKR-related work stays relevant in everyday work. If you miss that, you might have the situation that one cycle, it works fine, but you miss the chance to continuously improve and talk about what actually worked and didn't work, so that the next cycle, it works a little bit less, and then the next cycle, a little bit less and less and less. And that's by this, you are eroding the efficiency of the OKRs itself. And as I said, the three dots are supposed to signal these are not all potential measures to ensure the relevance of OKRs in everyday work, but these are some of the most common ones we see with our customers. And what we are deep diving into right now is the topic in the middle, initiatives. So what is actually the difference between OKRs and initiatives? I believe I'm not telling anybody in this webinar anything new, but please bear with me for 1 minute so we make sure that we all jump off of the same knowledge base. So obviously, OKR as a framework is an agile leadership and goal management framework, even though, to be honest, today it's called agile, but 10 years ago it wasn't called agile in the same sense. But it's easy to call it agile because it's honestly based on kind of the same values and principles, like, for example, scaled agile frameworks like DAAD, safe, less, etc. And OKRs can be seen as a strategy execution tool to help companies to become more outcome focused, to align better and create more engagement around measurable goals. And OKRs obviously consist of objectives and key results in theory. That said, maybe one more opening slide in order to jump off of the same knowledge base. Let's talk 1 minute about the OKR principles behind every implementation of the OKR framework or behind every strategy execution leveraging OKRs. There are a couple of principles we like to focus on. One is OKRs can help with continuous learning, like we just said. Like every iterational process, by shortening the iterations, for example, from a 3-year strategy cycle to 3 months OKR cycles in order to actually execute this strategy, you gain possibilities minimum after each cycle to continuously learn. And obviously the meeting focusing on this continuous learning is the retrospective. Next one is you can foster more alignment. That's a problem or a challenge most big corporations face, that they are so big and that there are so many topics in parallel and so many teams working on those topics in parallel that it's easy to lose the sight for how to align, with whom to align, and to align on what. So by having these short cycles to execute your strategies with OKRs, by having the specific meetings or phases in the OKR cycle, you're giving alignment more room and make it more prominent. Next one is obviously OKRs can help with communicating and with transparency regarding your strategy. What a lot of our customers are facing is the fact that every company has some kind of strategy. And within the company, then there are numerous strategies derived from this top strategy. And then it goes down and down and down. And what most companies and most of our customers struggle with is having to make sure that everybody actually understands this strategy. It's easy to communicate it by having a big town hall meeting, by sending around emails, communicating other documentation formats, by putting up posters with the new strategy. But by just communicating the strategy, you don't actually make the strategy itself consumable. So you can try it out if you'd like to just walk in the canteen in your office, if you're not working from home, obviously, and ask 10 random people whether they know the strategy. Most will say, yeah, kind of. And then whether they actually feel like the strategy is consumable for them by asking, do you know how to contribute to the strategy? And are you actually contributing to the strategy on a daily or weekly or monthly basis? And by asking the second question, you will realize After the initial question, yeah, I kind of know the strategy, more than half of the people will probably tell you, no, the strategy is not really consumable for me. And I don't have the feeling that I can actually contribute to it. And OKRs actually mitigate a process to make strategy more consumable. Next one is, by focusing while drafting on the topic to draft actually with your customer in mind, you obviously raise customer focus and you focus on continuous value creation, because again, you are trying to execute your strategy iteratively. Next one is, like for example, Scrum or other agile frameworks, the OKR framework is at its heart a metric and data-driven framework. So an empirical process which makes data-driven decisions more or easier, enables data-driven decisions. Because for one, you collect data around the process of strategy execution. And second, if drafting is done correctly, you try to integrate metrics and KPIs itself in the key results. And then three more. One is engagement and team empowerment. What a lot of corporations face is by missing this link between strategy and operative work, you don't really engage people, you don't empower teams to execute your strategy. And OKRs can obviously help with that. And connected to that, I can speak out of experience. What is kind of often the case in big corporations that the purpose is missing. So I know what I'm working on a daily basis, but purpose means something more. So what am I counting in by doing what I do on a daily basis? So what's the bigger purpose behind it? And by having your strategy made more consumable and executed in iterations of 3-4 months, you can give teams and your employees more purpose. And the next one, which is kind of obvious, is OKRs are always a limited number of OKRs. So each unit shouldn't have like 15 objectives with each 15 key results, because then it would have just been another form of documenting what you are trying to do. It should imply a prioritization and by this a focus to, let's say, 5 objectives with each 4 key results per unit. That said, let's take a look how we are executing the OKRs, because it's connected to initiatives as well. So the cycle we are referring to is, like I mentioned earlier when talking about the potential measures, is we got a planning phase and drafting phase, we got an execution phase and an adaption phase, starting with the announcement of organizational priorities, meaning can be North Star metrics, it can be organizational OKRs, then the team and department drafting, alignment phases or workshops, refining the OKRs based on the outcome of those workshops, then the kickoff, and then diving into the execution, weekly check-ins, and at the end, retrospective and reviews, which can all, by the way, or should all, by the way, it be integrated in existing meetings as much as possible. That said, coming to the actual connection between OKRs and initiatives. What we are trying to focus on when working with our customers is having OKRs as a new puzzle piece means we got a company strategy, which we had before, we got strategic KPIs, hopefully, which we had before, and we got operational KPIs. This is all input for our OKRs itself. But after deriving the OKRs, you still do have the question on, you answer the question, where do I want to go and how can I measure where I want, whether I reached my goal? But you haven't answered the question, what do I actually have to do in order to get there? And the answer to this question is initiatives. And it can be in this example, if your teams, your organization is working, for example, with Jira in a more agile approach, then initiatives can be epics, user stories. So issues in Jira itself. So what we are trying to focus on is the understanding that OKRs need something else in order to be more relevant in your daily work. You need a linkage between the strategic puzzle piece OKRs and your operative work, which is usually organized not in the OKRs itself, but in different other formats. So we usually differentiate in a long-term strategy process between the following elements. We do have the question of what do I need? So resources. We do have the question of what possible input do I have for deriving my strategy? So what will I do? I have the output. I have the customer outcome, which is what most companies initially focus on when implementing OKRs. It's the OKRs itself. And we got the business impact, so the KPIs measuring whether we achieved what we set out to achieve. And what we are trying to aim for right now is making it more transparent that, yes, we want to focus on a more outcome-driven work, but still we need output in order to create outcome. And the output is usually formulated in some kind of initiatives. Bringing me to the basic overview, the connection between OKRs and initiatives is I have the objective, which answers the question, where do we want to go? I do have the key result, which answers the question, how do I actually measure if we get where we want to go? And then last but not least, which in our sense, in our opinion, is a crucial part of OKR implementation in every company, is the question, what do we actually need to do on a daily basis to get where we want to go? So, and that's what we call initiatives. To make it a little bit more plastic, a couple of slides visualizing this connection. So on the left-hand side, we got the objective, in this case, with three different key results, which usually should be drafted in a way that it describes outcome. If you described it in an outcome-driven way, then you still have the question of what kind of output do I need to create this outcome? And this is the actual project management, if you would call it like this, or daily product work. And we call it initiatives, initiative 1, 2, 3 in this picture, which then is put on a roadmap consisting of, for example, in this case, 3 months. So a 3 month OKR cycle. What can be initiatives? We get often asked once we throw in the word initiatives, we get the question, what is an initiative? And an initiative actually is to be seen in the context of your company, to be seen in the context of your way of working. So if you're a classical project organization, whether it's agile project or classical waterfall project, doesn't matter, or hybrid way, a project itself can be an initiative. A work package within the project or program can be an initiative. If you're working in a more agile fashion and using, for example, the Atlassian tool suite or any other tool, by the way, leveraging Scrum, then it could be epics or user stories. And if you're doing none of this, not working in a project, not working in an agile team, but still doing important work to drive the strategy, then it can be any kind of task, because usually nearly every employee has some kind of task management. And those tasks are the ones we want to tackle with when talking about initiatives. Moving forward, how are initiatives and OKRs then connected? And in our opinion, it could be like this. Objectives do have key results, and then we do have initiatives. We need to link the initiatives to the OKRs, but not to the objectives, but to the key results. So you can kind of see initiatives as some way a hypothesis of impact on the key result. So you ask yourself, if I want to achieve this KPI, which is hopefully mentioned in the key result itself, what do I have to do? And what do I have to do is described in an initiative. Again, in a project, a work package, a user story, or any kind of task. To make it maybe even more transparent or obvious, we try to give you a hint here how to distinguish output versus outcome thinking. So on the left-hand side, we see output. And please don't see red and green as some kind of judgment. Both is valid and we need both. But on the left-hand side, we do have an output-driven formulation, like I have studied for my math test. I spent more time with my grandma, Our core product has been relaunched, or we have executed all aspects on the roadmap. All good things to do, but it's all doing, so it's output. If we are looking at the outcome side of those tasks, it could be, I passed my math test with the highest grade as the top of my class. Or my grandma feels valued since she can teach me how to cook when we spend time together. Or the engagement with our product is much higher since the relaunch. And last but not least, it might be that the roadmap works towards a purchasing process. So the outcome could be, we provided our users with a frictionless purchasing process that requires less time. So you see, we need both. In order to pass my math test with the highest grade, I obviously need to study for my math test beforehand, at least most people do. So we need the outcome as a goal, and we need the task as an output. One more example to make it even more plastic. We got output and outcome, output on the left side and outcome on the right side. We got the same objectives. Users start to buy event tickets of their favorite stars on our app and love it. I believe most of you will probably know some kind of app where you can buy concert tickets. Such a company could have an objective like we phrased it here. What can be potential key results? We could say we released our application to the App Store would be a very outputty key result. If we've drafted in a more outcome-driven way, it could be our app hits 4.5 average rating on the App Store. Next one, all steps on the buy ticket flow are implemented is again the doing, the output. The outcome could be we sell 1,000 tickets through our app. And last but not least, output would be we fixed 15 bugs in the buy ticket flow. An outcome behind it would be our buy ticket flow shows a 10% conversion rate. So again, you see, in order to realize the outcome on the right-hand side, we probably need to do what we drafted on the left-hand side as key results before. So both are valid, but not both are good key results. So the outcome key results on the right-hand side and the output on the left-hand side might be better initiatives. Which you can see here, we took the key results, the output-driven key results on the left-hand side in the example on the slide before, and moved them to the initiative layer. So by having the goal that our app hits a 4.5 average rating on the App Store, we obviously first need to release our application to the App Store. We probably need to do a lot more than releasing the app in order to hit a 4.5 average. But nevertheless, to make one example, the release of the application itself is then one initiative which needs to be linked to the key results, to the key result of reaching the 4.5 average. That said, coming to the question of how to derive initiatives from your OKRs. On the left-hand side, you see the OKRs itself. On the right-hand side, you see your operative work. In this example, organized in a Kanban or a Scrum board. What we are trying to work on with our customers is not only implementing the OKRs and leaving the operative work as it is, but trying to connect this. So what is described on the operative side are, again, epics, user stories, initiatives, other tasks to do, and they should be linked to the key results in order to make your OKRs more relevant in everyday work. Because if you don't do that, people will keep working on their operative work and asking themselves, how am I contributing to the strategy and contributing to our OKRs by having this operative work? By linking them, you are answering that question. So again, another example. If the users start to buy event tickets of their favorite stars on our app and love it again, we could have a key result, for example, showcase 30% of the world's larger music events. Behind that, we obviously then need to deduce and brainstorm initiatives. So ask ourselves, how could we move the needle on this key result? How can we actually get to 30%? And then an answer or help could be in asking yourself which initiatives could contribute best to the value we want to provide, which is described by itself in the key result. So you could do a matrix like visualized on the left-hand side, picturing all your initiatives and asking yourself, if I put this initiative in context with the key result, so the 30% of the world's events, with this key result, which initiatives actually has the biggest impact on this key result with obviously the lowest resource invest? And those are the initiatives I want to link to the key result. And obviously I want to focus on in order to actually achieve the KPI mentioned in the key result. And it can be point three, every flight level. Important is only that the flight level, whether it's a sprint goal, an epic, a user story, a working package in a project or a simple task, it needs to be manageable and doable in one OKR cycle, obviously. So it doesn't make sense to link a 5-year program on the highest level to a key result, which we want to finish in 3 months. So obviously then I would need to pick some working package or partly a project out of this program to link to my key result, because a working package might be able to be finished after the same OKR cycle. And then fourth step is then the filling of your backlog or your task management tool in order to actually link what you're doing daily with the OKRs you committed to. That said, here you see another example. The objective in this example could be we have solved our customers' biggest problems with our checkout process. A key result could be we reduce the bounce rate from checkout by 10%. So obviously we don't want want our customers to move through the process and then before checkout actually leaving the process again, because obviously we get money at the checkout. So initiatives connected to that could be adding PayPal as a payment method or improving the UI color scheme. By using the example we just saw on the slide before, you could picture again the matrix and asking yourself, is the UI colors or PayPal a bigger impact on the bounce rate with lower resource invest? And in this case, we came exemplary to the conclusion that the UI colors has the bigger impact, or maybe the same impact more or less than PayPal, but it's definitely a smaller resource invest. So adding PayPal would take more time, more money, more people to actually achieve than improving our UI color scheme. So by this, we do have two epics, PayPal and the UI colors, and we have an implicit prioritization between those epics by saying that the UI colors and PayPal are both with a high impact, but one of those is easier to implement because it needs a lower resource invest. Next question we want to tackle real quick is how initiatives can help your goal achievement. So you remember this picture we talked about 1 minute ago, OKRs on the left-hand side, your project management or your value creation, your way of working on the right-hand side, in this example, a Kanban or Scrum board. We got in the middle our initiatives, which we linked to the key results and visualized on the Kanban board. And then what you should do next is actually connect it back. So you don't just say at the beginning, I create this value mentioned in the key result by working on this initiatives, but you should do weekly check-ins, like a daily, a weekly, a project you will fix in order to make your progress transparent and in order to make it easier to communicate with your stakeholders. That said, here a short reminder for the check-in as a fact sheet. A check-in can be something similar to a daily Scrum or a project you will fix. It can happen daily, it can happen weekly, it can happen bi-weekly. That's all depending on your adaption of the OKR framework. But one benefit is it can be facilitated in a way that you get transparency regarding your initiatives, the progress on your initiatives, and by this transparency regarding the overall implementation of your key results in itself. That said, that's the theoretical input we wanted to share today. And having talked about this right now for around 40 minutes, I would like to open up the floor for questions or your thoughts around this. And I see we already got a couple of questions in the Q&A function itself. I may start with Martin's questions. What are the differences between OKR and the target agreement system, and what are the similarities, if any? I wouldn't say there's a big difference. That's one example of the adjacent processes which need to be integrated, in our opinion. So what you do when rolling out or implementing OKRs is not just putting OKRs in between the strategy and then the operative work. That's one thing, but you need to connect it to every adjacent process. And one of the adjacent processes is how do you do target agreements today as a status quo? Are we talking about personal targets? Are we talking about team targets? These are all questions you need to answer upfront. And I would say OKRs are not different from a target agreement process system. If you have one, they should be part of the target agreement system. So for example, having team goals. Team goals could be described in team OKRs. So by connecting your previous target agreement system where teams derive team targets and now OKRs, and saying OKRs are your new team targets, you actually connect the adjacent process of target management and OKRs, and by this making OKRs more relevant in your daily work. I hope that question that answers your question, Martin. Moving to the next one, Chris asked, what are the key elements, aspects, and differences for applying OKR on team level when you are explicitly not allowed to include the breakdown of OKRs on the level of the individual? OKRs can be applied and should be applied throughout the whole organization. So in order to gain the biggest benefit from an OKR implementation or from a strategy execution leveraging OKRs, you need OKRs on the top level up until the lowest level, which is usually the team level. And the key elements or the aspects for applying OKRs on a team level are not that different from on an organizational level. Obviously, the drafting itself, the input sources, the communication differs a little, but the general principles are the same. And what I always try to talk with customers about at the beginning is the one slide we talked about today, where you saw the 8 principles or the 8 benefits you can gain from an OKR implementation. And those benefits should be the same throughout the whole organization. Obviously, a team can have maybe an added benefit, or on organization level, you can have another added benefit. But at the core, if you say we want to increase our focus in the organization, or we want to increase the transparency regarding strategy in our organization, then that's a goal for the organizational level, the main department, the department, and the team. So I wouldn't say there's a big difference between the key elements. I hope that answers the question at least a little bit. That's obviously a question where you would need to dive in and take more time that we have on a webinar. But I'm happy for everybody on the call to contact us afterwards, obviously. That said, I would say let's move to the next one. Christelle asked about initiatives. You asked, this is what should be communicated to the countries so that they know what will be concretely developed according to the OKR. I assume by countries you connect your daily life in your company where you are an initial international company working with different countries. So yeah, definitely initiatives should be communicated, but if you communicate initiatives on a broad scale, you communicate quite a lot. Imagine initiatives being user stories. And imagine the number of user stories just one single team can actually implement in one quarter. So if they are doing 2-week sprints, they got 6 sprints worth of user stories. So you obviously don't want to communicate on a broad scale the initiatives, the user stories then. When communicating, I would definitely focus on the OKRs and not on the initiatives. You could jump to the initiatives when actually aligning on contributions. That makes it easier. So if you get a key result for which you need the contribution of a neighboring team, it makes sense to start with the key result, but then jump into the initiative layer and talk about what's the doing we need you to do in order to help us reach our key result. But on a broad scale, I would focus on the OKRs, not on the initiatives when communicating. We got time for a couple more. Thomas asked, what happens when the corporate strategy level is missing because it is really implicit? Can OKRs work? What steps would you suggest? OKRs can work even if you only use one team or implement it in one team. But obviously, the benefits are more transparent, more obvious, and easier to gain if you do it from top to bottom and the other way around. But we see that quite a lot, that big corporations start implementing OKRs. And what happens is a leadership circle asked the organization to work with OKRs, but the leadership circle itself don't start actually drafting organizational OKRs by themselves. One mitigating measure, which I would give you on your way, Thomas, is at least ask the leadership circle for some other kind of guidance. Obviously, our opinion is the best kind of guidance for the organizational level are organizational OKRs. But if that's not your first step, a first step can be that the organizational level or the leadership circle behind this organization level at least communicates North Star KPIs on which they want to improve in a specific margin. For example, this quarter, we want to focus on 10% more revenue. Very, very easy example. I believe your reality will be more complex. But if they don't draft OKRs on the organization level, they should at least have a strategy and derived North Star KPIs from that and say, let's focus on improving KPI 1, 2, and 5 this quarter by N%. That's the basic minimum you need in order to draft OKRs. Good OKRs, at least. You can draft OKRs even without this input, but then obviously, if the strategy is on the organization level and not made consumable and no more input is given, then the OKRs drafted on the levels below won't actually make sure that your strategy is implemented. So every organization level has an intrinsic motivation to give more guidance, I believe. And what we usually do then is work with those leadership circles in some kind of workshops to try to explain the benefits by giving more guidance and drafting with them actual company OKRs based on their strategy. Thomas has another question. The outcome key results are great, but are they realistic to achieve in 3 months if you have to implement it? App store rating, etc. Yeah, obviously, Thomas, you're right. The examples we picked might not be realistic in every company. So they are just examples. And we believe and we know for a fact out of the reality of our customers, yeah, there are outcome-driven key results which are realistic to achieve, but you obviously always have to transfer them to your context and ask yourself, what can actually be achieved? What is realistic? What is ambitious, but still realistic? And the examples we picked might not be for your case. Next one. Christelle has another question too. Can we see in WorkPath the link between initiatives and key results? Yes, you can. Otherwise, it would be kind of stupid of me to do a webinar based on the linkage of initiatives to key results. So yeah, that's one of our newest features that we, for example, integrated the Jira. So if you, for example, formulated your initiatives in Jira items, you can link the initiatives now to the key results and make them even put them on a roadmap. If you filled out, for example, due dates and target dates in the original source Jira. Next one is anonymous, but the question might be valid nevertheless. With outcome key results, I feel it is similar to an objective. What if I immediately put the initiative as a key result? So outcome key result shouldn't be similar to an objective for one. It should be connected, but the objective is phrased in a qualitative way. You usually don't have something measurable in it. That's why the key results come in. So the objective answer the question, where do we want to go? But it's not yet measurable. The key results then answer the question, how can we actually measure if we get to where we want to go? And you ask if it's all right to put the initiatives in the key results. Sure, it's all right. We always try to say there are different ways to adapt the OKR framework, but by adapting it, you get different benefits out of it. So for example, by putting the initiatives directly in the key result, you might lose the possibility to actually measure the objective, because most key initiatives we see are not drafted in a way like a key result should be drafted or could be drafted, including a lead indicator in there, which the team who's drafting can actually influence. By losing this indicator, which could be in the key result, and replacing it with the initiative itself, so the actual doing the output, you as a minimum lose the possibility to measure if you actually achieved the objective. But nevertheless, we always try to work with our customers. If right now you aren't actually making your strategy consumable, you aren't even drafting objectives. And if that's the case, and you start with OKRs and draft good objectives, qualitative objectives, which are part of the outcome orientation too, but don't draft outcome-oriented key results, but put the initiatives directly in the key results, it's still a benefit. You still make it more transparent what output, what initiatives are connected to what objective. You still make the strategy execution more realistic by deriving objectives out of your strategy. So yeah, you can do it and you still will gain a benefit, but you will lose the, or you might lose the possibility to actually measure whether you gained that benefit. Sorry, next one was Matthias. Matthias asked, how can I ensure to include employees in a company, tax consultant law firm in this case, where most of them do operational daily tasks and there's a lot of room, there's not a lot of room of improvement that can be influenced by them? That's kind of a common question, Matthias. One step we mentioned earlier is to do a capacity plan. So by having it transparent that you do have, maybe in your case, then a large percentage of your daily work not connected to OKRs, you make it, for one, transparent. And by this, reducing maybe the overhead of having to draft and align OKRs, because if you got less OKRs, because you got less capacity to work on them, you need less time to actually draft and align them. But in our experience, most companies still have some room for improvements. So even if it's just an operational daily task, which isn't plannable, I work on 2,000 tickets per quarter. I still usually do have the goal to increase the number of tickets I work on in the same time, or reduce the number of time I need to work on the same amount of tickets. Same thing, but differently phrased. And in order to achieve that, I still need some process adjustment, process improvements. Even though if it's just 5%, 10% of your time, it still makes sense in our experience to formulate them in OKRs. Natalia has another question. Should initiatives be linked only to key results, or they could also be linked to objectives? That's kind of similar to what I just talked about when answering, I believe, Matthias's question. Was it, could we put initiatives directly in the key results? Because Natalia, what you're implying would be the same thing. You do have an objective, a qualitative goal, but you can't or don't want to, or not yet draft measurable key results below, but directly link the objectives to it. You can do it, but it's the same thing I just talked about. If you do have key results, which are measurable, then I don't see any benefit in linking the initiatives directly to the objective, because the key results are the way to measure whether you achieve the objective. In the key result, you do have a KPI, and in order to achieve this KPI, you do have a doing, so an initiative. So I don't see any valid reason to directly link to the objective if you do have proper key results. I see two more questions. I believe we might be able to finish them. Martin asked, setting OKRs for 2022, how should we start? From MB level or leave this level and start with setting OKRs for B1 level? You should start on the level where your strategy is derived. So in a perfect world, somebody on some level in your organization derives a strategy or formulates, drafts a strategy. And this level could start with drafting organizational OKRs, announcing them, and by this giving the levels below the input they need to draft their own OKRs, even though it's always 40% or something as a rule of thumb top-down input and 60% bottom-up input, you still need the top-down input. So easy answer is start on the level where the strategy is allocated to. But if that's not possible, as I said before, try to convince this level to at least allocate strategic KPIs, which you want to improve in the next quarter, cycle, or year, in this case, 2022, as some kind of guidance for the levels below. That way you could start on any level you want to start. Next one, Betty asked, what's the relationship between OKR and KPI? Can OKR replace KPI? No, definitely not, because good OKRs include KPIs. So you remember maybe the slide I showed earlier where we do have a strategy, we do have strategic KPIs, we do have operational KPIs. And we usually try to differentiate between leading KPIs or leading indicators and lagging indicators. And the leading indicators are the ones who should be included in good key results. So OKR make a connection between the KPIs and what to do. What are your goals by using the KPIs? Because you should never work on just the goal without anything to measure whether you achieve it. And the measurement are the KPIs. Last but not least, again, an anonymous question regarding Matthias's question and my answer. Doesn't it lose the aspect of focus in case you only apply 5 to 10% of your time to OKRs? Yes and no, because by having OKRs itself in place, even if it's just for 5 to 10% of your time, I believe it's not less important, if anything, even more important to use OKRs in order to make sure that you spend this limited resource, so only 5 to 10% of your time, on the right topics. Because if you miss that chance to actually prioritize and draft your OKRs, you got the risk of not only do you have very limited time to work on strategic topics, but you got the risk of working on the wrong strategic topics or on topics which aren't aligned enough. So I would say no, you don't lose focus, you increase focus by having OKRs for those 10%. That said, I'm hoping we answered most of your questions, at least partly. Having that said, I would finish up with one thing, one info. Obviously, you get the slides afterwards and a lot more than those slides you've seen here as a content package, which we will provide. And the other one is an invitation to reach out to us if we can support you in any way. If you want to discuss any of those topics further, if you feel like your company might need some assistance, whether it's the software as a starting point or it's the enablement, we are happy to discuss this. If you feel like this, please reach out if we can support you. That said, thanks for attending, and I'm hoping to see you next webinar. We usually do that on a monthly basis, so stay tuned on our social media platforms. Thank you.